In this video, we will continue to put the overall situation we're in into the big picture context, which actually calms us down more than anything. We stop getting lost in the minutia of details, stop getting lost in the forest because of the trees, and start recognizing what the boundaries of the forest really are, so that we can make our way out of this deep, dark forest that we have been in for quite some time. So we'll use some visuals here. What I've done is I've divided the context up into three periods for us. The first period on the left here, is I call it the time of the great gurus and teachers, let's say 1879 to 1979, 100-year period there. This came prior to the cycle overlap, 33-year period of stalemate between one cycle and the next cycle that's replacing it. This is the time of grace, 1980 through 2013, and we're just now coming to an end of that 33-year cycle. It may continue through October, as it were. We'll see. The third part of this is unknown as of this point, unknown. But certainly we are going to enter into a new phase, I believe, during the month of October. We will begin to enter into a new phase, probably towards the end of October. It may become very ripe for us. So this sort of helps us say, okay, where have we been? And by knowing where we've been, we are going to be more ready for where we're going. So the great gurus and teachers, I'm saying it, Ramana Maharshi is born in 1879. And he's certainly a great teacher, no question about it. What these great teachers told us and showed us was that what we are deserves more than what existence has to give us. I think that's it in a nutshell. They just relayed to us this information that you deserve better than this. And you're entangled in this web of confusion. And there's a way to get untangled from it. We are all deserving of what they were experiencing, which is this seamless bliss. We're deserving of that. And they say it's within us, but that we just don't accept it. We turn away from it and refuse to accept it for ourselves because of all the confusion and entanglements, guilt, the fear, the karma, etc., etc. Things just keep distracting us away from it. So by doing this big buildup, 100-year buildup before the overlay of two cycles, they instilled in us this sense, a feeling, a knowing that, hey, we're better than this. We deserve better than what existence has for us. That this dance of impermanence is not really our home. It's not, we deserve better than this. Okay? So when this, then the new cycle started coming into the world, we were able to say, meet the new boss, same as the old boss, right? We won't get fooled again. We were able to say that. He said, I know this is a new cycle. Here come all the gadgets. Here come all the gadgets. You know, here come the cell phones. No, I don't have a smartphone. I decided to draw the line somewhere. Have to do that. Can't keep chasing the dragon of technology, or else you keep going down the rabbit hole further and further. And it's like, okay, here come all the gadgets, here come all the glass beads, like the colonialists came to the Indians on Long Island and said, hey, they had a chest full of Venetian beads, glass beads, and they said, look at this stuff is incredibly valuable, kings, our kings want this stuff, it's amazing, it's just super valuable, And how would it look to be on a necklace around your neck? You'd be very unique. You'd be exalted among the other Indians. And how would you like to have a necklace made of these beads? And the Indians said, oh my God, there's anything like it. And they thought, this stuff is really cool. You know, it's got some spiritual charisma to it. And they said, all we want is to fish in your rivers. You know, we just want to get some fish and hunt a little bit. And the Indian said, go be my guest. Nobody owns the land anyway. You want to pull some fish out of the river? There's fish for everybody. It's not a problem. They said, my gosh, in return we get these gorgeous glass beads, and it makes us look, you know, we feel like this has got some sort of power from the Great Spirit. So they made a deal, and said, here's Long Island, yeah, no problem. Or something like that effect, you know. But the colonialists knew the value of the beads, okay? So they weren't honest about the situation. And the Indians didn't know what it would lead to. They didn't realize that the colonialists would start staking out property rights and fencing and boundaries and all this stuff. They didn't have that. The colonialists were not honest with the Indians. Just like these peddlers of technology, high tech, and all the gadgetry and all this stuff, they're not being honest with the world either, for sure. They're saying, look at all this stuff. Look what you can do. Look at the picture. You can send a picture to someone across the planet. You know, it's all about the iPhone, how wonderful. Look at the picture. I took a picture. Here's a picture. Oh, you know. And all this stuff they're doing, it's really just junk. It's not entirely junk. I mean, glass beads are pretty, but it's just pretty stuff. There's nothing of substance really there. And in turn, we are basically handing over the globe to them. Very bad deal. Very bad deal. And, you know, they're not being honest at all. I mean, I don't know of any place that has more dishonesty in it than the internet, actually. Just a cesspool of shysters constantly baiting you into various things, you know, and just pretending, you know, they're all nice and everything's free and blah, 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 blah. Horrible. They're like the new colonialists. And we're like the new, you know, the Indians. And they're saying, wow, you got your new smartphone. Incredible. You're incredible. You're incredible. Oh, you just took a picture with it? Oh, that's awesome. What did you do with it? Oh, you posted it on Facebook? Oh my God. OMG, OMG, OMG. That is just like hashtag OMG. I'm just so completely cool. I'm just so cool. and this is my life. I mean, my life has been exalted, inspired. I'm inspired. This is amazing. Where's the content? No content. Oh, no content. I mean, where's the value? Where's the real meaning? Et cetera, et cetera. But meanwhile, you know, empower, 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 empower the you know, the techies. And they say, thank you very much. We'll take over the world and we'll regulate everything and we'll put you in this regulatory straitjacket. That, you know, down to counting how many breaths you breathe in your lifetime. Oh, you're up to, you know, 5 million breaths. You know, okay, that's enough breaths for you. We don't know what we're getting into. Most people don't. But imagine if back then, in the pilgrim time of America, there were pilgrims, colonialists who came over and they knew the value of the glass beads, and they said, yeah, I can go down. Ship comes in from Venice to London, and I can go down to the dock, and I can negotiate and buy a trunk of beads, and, you know, okay, so what? What am I going to do with them? They're pretty, but little baubles. And then they go over to the New World, North America, and they see what's going on, and they go to the Indians and say, hey, Indians, do you know what you're getting into here? That they're taking over your land. You're not going to be welcome on their land anymore. They're buying the land from you, buying the riverine rights, the hunting rights, the building rights, the access rights, the easement rights, the, you know, building rights, everything. They own it now. Do you know what they're going to do? They're going to develop it, and you're not going to be personas non gratis, and What if that person told the Indians that and said, hey, don't fall for this stuff. There's no value. You're getting gypped. You're getting cheated. You're getting conned. Come on. Hey, that person would be acting responsibly, wouldn't they? So there are those who are very much aware of tech land. There is a whole domain, as it were, in the cosmos. And on August 18th, 1999, I was shown this domain. Somehow, some sort of spiritual vision opened up, and I became aware of a whole nother domain, a whole nother world. And I was there, and I was walking around, I was looking at everything, and I got this full picture of what it's like. And this is gadget land, as I call it. And the people, the techies in the world now, are from gadget land. They've reincarnated upon this planet, bringing with them all their habits and customs. And they're saying, gee, you're going to have an incredibly cool future. But no, you won't. No, you won't. Not at all. It's a stifling type of, just a very, very immature type of delay, very unfortunate type of situation. I felt like my spirit would almost felt like I was dying. I felt physically I was going to die if I didn't get out of that vision. And I did. I said, wow, I don't ever want to see that again. It's like, on the surface, it seemed everybody seems happy, and they all have got their little, you know, electronic games and gadgets, and everyone's doing, doing, little robots all over the place and stuff. And you think, wow, this is interesting. But you get this feeling that there's no soul there, there's no spirit there, there's nothing really there. You know, it's so dead. It's so dead. Just terrible. So there are people who are aware of this. And the responsibility, of course, is to tell others in this world, hey, don't make that deal. Don't make that deal. Unfortunately, the Indians, maybe someone did say it to the Indians. I imagine they would. Maybe a good Christian would have said that. They should. And or a good any group, any person. But I think it was mostly Christians that came at that time. Merchants and maybe some pilgrims would tell the Indians, hey, look, that don't take the deal. You don't know what you're getting in for. You don't. Very bad deal. Same thing here. Very bad deal to get into this high-tech gadgetry stuff. But the world is not listening. The world is not listening. Fortunately for us, prior to the advent of technology, and I don't know when some of the advancements in technology arose, but I can tell you that probably around this time frame of 1980, there were some significant motion taking place at this time. And basically, during this last 33 years is the time, which I say the overlap of this next cycle, which is coming from being inaugurated by the tech people, the people from tech land, as it were, gadget land, bringing in the foundation, as it were, of this next cycle. During this last 33 years, this is when it has taken place. Okay. Prior to that, you had these great teachers here. There were quite a few. There's some Rinpoches from, you know, there's some Tibetan teachers that were really, really powerful. There were some Buddhist teachers, very powerful. There were some Advaitin teachers. There were, you know, various types of teachers here on this planet that were quite profound. And they gave us this sense that we deserve something truly glorious, and we can have it. And so when all this tech stuff comes in, you kind of like saying, we're saying like, okay, but where's the beef? You know, there's the bun, the lettuce, the tomatoes, the onions, everything, but where's the beef? You open up the bun, it's not there. Where is it? You know, where is the it to it? They call it IT, but where is the it to the IT is the question. There is no it to it. It's not there. It is not there at all. So as this overlap has happened, it's like we're scratching our heads and saying, wait a minute, this doesn't seem to be going in the right direction here. There's something missing. There's something really, really missing here. It seems like shallow. There's a shallowness to it. It's like all this data, but there's a shallowness to it. There's a lack of depth to it. There's a lack of wisdom to it. And you know, here in the Silicon Valley, I've been here through this entire 33-year period and prior to that. So I am completely aware of the entire unfolding of the entire situation. I mean, just down the road, as Apple started just down the road, and you're surrounded by all this, you know, eBay and Yahoo and Google and the Facebooks out there, and Oracle, of course, and so all these titans are constantly in the newspaper, in the news, and you know, it's just like never ending. And you see these people, and you say, no, wait a minute. You compare them with the gurus, okay? Compare them with the gurus. Compare like Larry Ellison with Ramana Maharshi, okay? Just fair comparison, make the comparison. Was he the third richest person in the country, or 40-something billion, or whatever? You know, a very powerful person, for instance. Where's the beef? You know, where is the beef? Compare the two. And you just say, wait a minute. You know, what's going on here? What is really going on here, actually? You want to entrust your destiny to the tech titans? Not to single any one of them out, but they're all here. And you really? Who in their right mind wants to say, okay, I put my destiny in your hands, which is what the world is doing? When you can compare them with the great gurus like a Ramana, like an Anandamayi, like a Punjaji, like a Sri Nisargadatta Guru, and like a Meher Baba, like a, you know, various and sundry, like a Ram Dass, the one in southern India, you know, I'm leaving some out. There were quite a few. Some say Ramakrishna. And various people have various opinions on who's who and what, etc. Whatever. It was a time where there's a lot of heavyweights. Neem Karoli Baba, there's one. A lot of heavyweights. And so those who are aware of the heavyweights, mostly in the East, it seems like the West had a problem generating some heavyweights, you know, Franklin Merrill Wolfe is one from the West, but not as much a heavyweight as some of these Indian gurus, really, and the Eastern gurus. There's some Zen masters, for sure. And compare those with the tech titans. There's also some rabbis, I think, in around the world that were quite amazing, quite heavyweights. It's a very profound time all around the world in many traditions. Sufis, there were some Sufis, profound Sufis. And compare those with the tech titans. Just compare them. And you can't help but say, uh-oh. We're putting our destiny in their hands, really? That's laughable. And yet, the people of the new cycle think nothing of that. Say, of course, these are our, you know, these are our people. This is who we follow. And it would be funny if it weren't for the fact that they're saying, and guess what? You get to follow them too. Lucky you. And of course we're saying, I don't think so. But they're saying, well, you know, you got no choice. So, that brings us to the third part of this with the question marks, okay? The question marks, which is this third phase that is now going to take place. What is that phase? And I would say that is the phase where we get to become aware of our options. When we say, no, no thanks, thanks but no thanks to the direction that the Tech Titans are taking us. No means no. No means no. And we get to make it stick. How about that? So, we are going to find out what our options really are. And we're not going to be circumscribed by the options that the world and the Tech Titans are telling us are our options. They basically have a blueprint for how they want the world to be. And it's coming from the tech land, and they're working with some other extraterrestrials and various groups and factions here in the world to try and bring about a materialistic paradise here, actually. And for them, that's what's happening. That's what's going to happen. And your options are, you know, how you adapt to it, basically. So they are unaware of really any other options. So we don't get it from them. We don't get it from the modern culture, what our options really are. We're not told. But fortunately for us, during the time of the great gurus and teachers around the world, we were informed. We were informed. At least to the extent that for sure we do have another option. Absolutely. And of course, throughout thousands of years on this planet, we have been informed by great, great spiritual teachers that we do have another option. And it's a glorious option, and it's a way to get free of the whole, you know, ideology of the flesh, which tells us that this world is our home, flesh is our home, the body is our self, we're supposed to dwell here and be happy endlessly, etc., etc. All this nonsense, we have an option to that. So it's been going on for thousands of years on this planet. We're being informed. But recently, 100-year period before the stalemate occurred of overlapping cycles, we had this about 100-year period where we got a tremendous boost. I remember people coming back from India. I lived in the Bay Area, and a lot of people from Bay Area went to India, as well as a lot of people from Europe and the eastern coast of the USA went to India, and then they came back and they were traveling all over the place, and, you know, people would like meet them and they would be just like wow, you know, I met this, you know, this guru, and I met a number of gurus, and you had Richard Alpert, which is, you know, took the name Ram Dass here in the, you know, in the US, meeting what Neem Karoli Baba and the various people going around meeting these gurus, and they came back and told us, like, my gosh, you know, these people are just incredible, and they have a higher vision for us than we have for ourselves, way, way higher. Richard Alpert gave Neem Karoli Baba like a vial of LSD, you know, and psychogenic, you know, chemical hallucinogens, and he said, what is this? He says, and they told him, he says, we had this thousands and thousands of years ago, but that is completely passe. He says, that is nothing. Says, that's not where it's at all. And then he took the vial and took it all, one shot. And Richard Alpert was like completely freaked out. He says, oh my God, he's gonna die. He's gonna completely go crazy. He's gonna destroy him. He says, what did you do? You know, he says, you're crazy. You just gotta take a tiny little bit. You took my whole stash. And Karoli Baba didn't experience anything. He just said, this is just lower stuff. You know, it's nothing. It just gets the lower mind, you know, to think it's all groovy. But no, what we're talking about here is completely transcendent of that, you know, no worries. So those stories kept, you know, trickling back, and people were meeting these incredible saints, really, and telling us, hey, there's some great saints in the world, and they're telling us that our destiny is a glorious destiny, and we can have it right now, And we deserve better than this fleshy realm, for sure. You also had the, you know, the Northern India had its saints, absolutely, the Sikh tradition, the Radha Swamis, all sorts of stuff were going on in many, many, many different ways. Krishnamurti, for instance, was talking, and he came to the West. Paramahansa Yogananda came to the West, and you know, so people were listening to Krishnamurti in Ojai, California, and they just said, my God, you know, this, he's just painting a picture for us that is showing us just how derelict we are and how we can truly transcend this dereliction. You know, there's a way, and we need to do this. And so people were just, you know, knocked out by this. It was a huge, huge deal. There was a buzz going on. This buzz continued through the 60s, built up during the 70s very powerfully. And then in, you know, let's say 1980, sort of starting with the hostage crisis in Iran, which was October, 22nd, 1979, something like that. Or it could have been a little later, I don't know, maybe November 14th or something. But anyway, late October, early November in 79, this new cycle started to make its presence felt. And people had their heads turned and said, well, wait a minute, what is this? Okay, and what does this have to do with you know, the transcendence of the flesh and all this stuff? What does it have to do with enlightenment? And gradually, you know, they began to have their heads turned. And they said, well, what is this? The computer, you know, I don't know when the computer came out, but I think it was, you know, in the late 70s probably, that I remember, because here in Silicon Valley, we got some of the first Apples, you know, early Apple computers. We were using them. I had one. Everybody had one here. And we're saying, okay, what is this? What is this? This is interesting. Draws a bunch of lines here and graphics and, hey, what is this? And then it kept developing and developing and developing, okay? And it starts snowballing, and here we are. Here we are, 33 years later. And we're saying, uh-oh, what happened to enlightenment? What happened to enlightenment? So, fortunately, I had such a connection to this whole enlightenment thing that I was aware of these teachers and aware of the teaching and the books and all of this. And it somehow the seed found some fertile soil in me and started growing. So along with all this computer stuff that was taking place here and observing it all, there was a continual process of spiritual effort taking place, saying, I don't think this is it. I don't think it's it. What's going on in the world? So we had this 33-year period where we've gotten to evaluate this new cycle. And so at this point now, the evaluation is pretty much needs to be complete. It needs to be complete because this grace period the door is being slammed shut on it now. Because this new cycle has reached a point, you know, like the Arab Spring, for instance. Those rulers of the country, they call them despots, but really, they were like strongmen keeping a tribalistic type of society together and keep them from warring and stuff. So they had to be strongmen. They had to keep the peace among very, you know, belligerent, bellicose factions in their country. It's not exactly the place where democracy is going to flourish. So suddenly the young people of the country start posting on their Twittering and Facebooking and deciding, you know what, let's stage a protest. And they all show up in the square, they all hang out, and they start saying, hey, you know what, let's occupy this building. You know, let's do this. Let's march. So they're able to marshal, the young people are able to marshal like a hive. And before you know it, a revolution is underway. And before you know it, you know, Well, the U.S. comes in and supports them, and then phew, gone is the old order. And what you get is anarchy in its place, actually. Look at Egypt. Look at Libya, etc., etc. So, you have a situation where the young people are very much rooted in the new cycle. Very much so. They see those who are coming from the old cycle as being incapable and unjustly sitting on the throne of power, incapable of using that power properly, incapable of empowering the younger generation towards what they want. And therefore they say, it's time to go. It is time to go. And it happens very fast. So what if on a global level, the youth, the people 33 and under, decided, you know what? The older generation cannot shepherd us properly towards our goals. So it's time for them to go. Time for them to go. Now, there have been some very astute politicians who have recognized this trend. The POTUS of the U.S. happens to be one of them, who said, hey, the way to survive is to act hip to the younger generation and say, we understand where you want to go, and we're going to make sure you get there. Thereby, you know, playing the role of a demagogue and being able to stay in power. But most of us, you know, are not like that. Not willing to do that, actually. So, really, the younger demographic at this point has shown its power to the world through all these revolutions. And they even got a revolution in Iran, really. I mean, there were a lot of protests in Iran, and it led to change of leadership there. Now you have this very liberal, relatively liberal, who also realizes we must now do what the younger demographic wants us to do. And so the world is literally being guided by the power of the younger demographic through the technology that they have, because politicians, being very savvy, realize, you know, you don't want all these demonstrations and protests and stuff going on throughout the social media networks, etc. It's bad for the corporation, as it were. Just like the feminists, for instance, the radical feminists, were able to terrify corporations in America and around the world through protests, all sorts of protests and lawsuits and, you know, the negative publicity. They were experts at generating negative publicity, and the LGBT community has also picked up on that, experts at that tactic, where anybody says anything they don't like, immediate, you know, global protest, right, and destroys the brand. People don't want to be associated with the brand. They say, oh, you bought this brand, don't you know that that's a boycott? I mean, oh, you're siding with, you know, with bigotry or something? And it's very effective. So the world is literally now super intimidated by the capacity to generate these flash protests, flash mob, so to speak, flash mobbing. So who's in power right now? It's actually the younger generation is in power. The other people are mostly figureheads, and they're realizing they've got to acknowledge that power, just as the corporations realize, hey, we have to adopt the sensitivity training that the feminists insist that we adopt. Otherwise, our brands, they're going to destroy our brand. And that's going on and on and on and on. It changes the world. It changes the landscape. People are scared. People are very scared. I've talked to young people, and they told me how scared they are. I've come across some that were telling me what's going on, like in their high school, and they say, you know, yeah, boy, you cannot say the wrong thing or do the wrong thing, you know, to many different groups there in the high school. Or says, you are in big trouble. And they say, we're all scared, very scared. So younger people, a lot of them, are very scared, and they've been raised in an environment where they are told the consequences are severe for their careers, for their life, if they don't follow along with what the activists want them to follow along with. So we don't realize in the world that this is the balance of power has shifted, actually. And you have to be objective about it. You can't be some old braggart saying, "No, we're still in control." No, we're not. Not in control. So I realize that. Definitely, the generation over 33 is not in control of this planet anymore. Not in control. And the sooner they realize that, the better. Because once you realize you really don't have any power in this world, especially going forward, then you'll say, "Hey, wait a minute, what are my options? What are my options?" So that brings us up to this question mark here is, what are our options? What are our options? That is what we want to know. And this is what we're going to find out now, starting in October. We're going to find out what our options are. Not the options that are given to us by, you know, the younger demographic saying, "Oh, this is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to map your future for you," etc. No, the options of how the Holy Spirit is going to map our future for us. What is the future the Holy Spirit gives to us? See, that is the question. And that is the question that we must insist that be answered for us. We must insist upon it. Now, the previous cycle kind of dealt with this, or tried to deal with this, and it was a little pretty fuzzy, wasn't very clear. So we need enhanced clarity at this time. So my role is to try to enhance the clarity of the situation as far as what are our true options in relationship to our true destiny, in relationship to God, relationship to the Holy Spirit. What are our true options? And clarify this. So it should be a very, very good month of October. I'm hoping I get to somehow take it easy, because I think I need to, actually, because I'm burned out. You know, my feeling is, if you've reached this point of the end of September 2013 and you're not burned out, there's something wrong with you, because you weren't really trying. That is my feeling, unless you've already succeeded. You know, unless you've already accepted the Holy Spirit's perfect no, then of course you'd be in bliss right now. But the others, I would think that the opportunity was so extreme during the last 33 years. By this time, however much effort you've made, you are probably very burned out, because you've been just working like crazy on this, trying to not get suckered, make a sucker's bet, you know. Don't get pulled in by the carnival barkers of the new cycle. You know, the Silicon Valley carnival barkers. Don't get conned by them. So you're probably burned out. I'm very burned out. It's like I gave everything I had, so there's nothing left. There's nothing in the tank. You know, so, you know, don't get down on yourself if you feel burned out right now. Just the opposite. Say, "Wow, I must have done a great job. I must have done a great job." And then be very hopeful that our options will begin to be clarified. So we need to begin to fill in these question marks with something, right? We need to begin to fill those in and find out what it is that we can really choose as an alternative. Because the people of the new cycle don't understand the old cycle at all. It's incomprehensible to them. They really can't. And some birds are making some interesting sounds as they nest down for the night. Very beautiful evening here in California, to tell you the truth. Super still, super pleasant. And the day was just like complete picture postcard day, about 88 degrees. Just an amazing day. But I was too tired to enjoy it. That's the problem. So being burned out, hopefully there's some relief coming up, because if there isn't, boy, I hate to think about it. Because, you know, if you know what's at stake, you go for broke. And so, you know, if you do that and you still don't succeed at all and there's nothing, that's pretty disheartening. It's not a good message to send out at all. So maybe a miracle will happen and I can actually take it easy. I don't know how that's possible, but I'm going to certainly pray for it. It'd be nice to have like a month or two or whatever just to, you know, truly relax and take it easy and recharge, if that's possible. And time to fill in these blanks, the question marks. Time to fill in the question marks and say, okay, now I can see. Now I see it. Now I see it. Now it's coming into view. Now it's coming into focus. And I believe it will. It is starting to come into focus for me for sure. I'm having some very profound experiences and insights that saying it's coming into focus. And but the big stuff is still yet to occur. It's occurred subliminally at a deeper level. It's already occurred, but it needs to, you know, the cork needs to come to the surface entirely here. So probably it will. And we can fill in the question mark of the third phase. Now we've gone through the two phases. The first, there was the buildup raising our expectations, okay, of the great gurus and teachers. Then there's been the stalemate period between the two cycles, which enabled us to consider what existence really is in the first place. During the stalemate period, we were able to get an overview on all of existence, actually. What is it? What's really going on? Because neither ideology was in charge. It was kind of like a time of sort of anarchy where we could just, nobody was quite, could quite crack our heads. You know, I mean, you could criticize the Catholic Church, for instance, during this time period, and it was okay. Whereas prior, you know, not so okay. You could criticize the techies because they hadn't done have the power yet to do anything, do much about it. So you could really be critical of both cycles at this 33 period time, which I certainly was, critical of both of them. And so this then enabled to say, wait a minute, what is existence? You don't have a cycle telling you how you must think. This is how you must think. Anyone who doesn't think this way is a criminal. And you know, you didn't have that. Because let's face it, that's what happens in cycles, is a whole bunch of ideology gets criminalized. For instance, the religions in this world have criminalized a lot of various ideologies that are now cycle, the next cycle is saying, oh no, that's great, this is the great stuff, you're the criminals, you know. So they're flipping the whole notion of what is criminal, turning it upside down, as it were. Of course, they say, well, they're turning it right side up, and you know, that's the big argument going on. And so we are now in this now third period where the techies, cycle two, now will have the clout, the power to...
Rossi, you on here?
Just a minute. They will have the power to criminalize what they want to criminalize. They have the power of intimidation and the power of criminalization, and they will decide who's a criminal and who's not. They will be the ones. They will be the ones deposing those they want to depose. And that is now here. It is now here. And you place healthcare in the hands of all of this, etc. You know, you've lost your leverage. We've lost our leverage in so many different ways. We've lost our freedom from being leveraged in that way. It's gone. All the executive orders, everything that's taken place over the last 33 years has really moved the ball towards the next cycle dictating, you know, what is acceptable, what is unacceptable, what is criminal, what is not criminal, what is allowable, how you function, how you be in the world, all of this. They're able to enforce it. They'll be able to enforce it. Whereas this last 33 years, they could not, neither side could enforce their way. So, free thinking allowed, you know, the free speech movement, took off in the Bay Area, Berkeley, it was a time where people started challenging and questioning the old cycle. You know, wow, wait a minute, I don't quite agree with this. What's going on? And that burgeoned into this period of stalemate where we could really question everything, which is what I did. Really questioned everything. Said, wait a minute, let's go back to the very basic premise of existence. What does this whole thing rest upon? What is existence? What's its purpose? Why is it here? Why are we here? What is truly going on? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Totally questioning all the basic stuff, whereas previously you could not do that. You'd be labeled a heretic. And sometimes you'd suffer the severe consequences and death from being a heretic. There are various different consequences, but it's sometimes very, very severe consequences. Now the new cycle also, you will suffer very severe consequences if you step out of the box of their ideologies, box of their belief. Free thinking will not be allowed, absolutely not. Of course, they will say it's necessary in order to save the planet, so they have all their rationale built up, but they always do, don't they? I mean, anyone who's going to crack heads always has their rationale built up. So they've rationalized it to themselves and bolstered it by all sorts of whatever, scientific facts, religious facts, whatever. So we're at that point. So really, free thinking, it will no longer be allowable. And you can feel it coming. Those who are free thinkers are very aware of the, the tentacles closing in, the net closing in, taking away, absolutely. And of course, those who are not free thinkers, so they're not paying any attention, so they don't know anything. They just shrug their shoulders and say, I don't know, as long as Costco has what I want, everything's fine. And we've seen, so much stuff coming out to light, the massive worldwide spying program, which, by the way, is still going on more than ever. Wall Street, it's chicanery there. Has that stopped? No, it didn't. Nobody went to jail at all for that. It's still completely going on, the way that it's always gone on, and more so probably. It just, everything is still, continuing on in this unabated towards a new world order. And the circumscribing of freedom. So you really don't have free speech. You don't have freedom of speech at all. You have drastic consequences, actually. Drastic consequences. If you say the wrong thing to the wrong person, your life is basically going to be ruined. Just like that. It's amazing what's taking place in the world right now. This is the power of the new cycle. They're flexing their muscles. And once they feel that they're going to be unopposed, then, it's on. They're going to bust heads. And unfortunately, from what I see, the new Pope has basically given them a blank check by what he's been saying. And that's huge. That's huge. Because the Catholics will be paralyzed to do anything. They'll think, wow, do I disobey the Pope on this? And, this is the direction that God, they'll be, in a quandary about it all. And with the Catholics paralyzed and a lot of Christians paralyzed, and then the so-called war between Islam and the West and all of that, in the state that it's in right now, the whole situation just opens the door for the activists to come in and stake their claim. And that's the end of that's the new cycle is in full swing at that point. So it is on. It is entirely on. I remember when Pope Benedict resigned, I realized, I said, that's it. It's over. I hit with tremendous anxiety at that point. Because he was actually standing up for the old cycle, as it were, and rejecting the new cycle. He rejected it, categorically rejected it. he resigned, which is the first time Pope has resigned in what, 1,000+ years or something, long, long time, maybe 1,300 years. It's like, wow, why? Because he knew it was over. It was over. He knew. Couldn't win. Losing battle, it was finished. And he could not take the pressure any longer. So when he resigned, I said, that's it. It's finished. And look out for the new pope. Because in the St. Malachi prophecies, this next pope is the anti-pope who's going to bring about the destruction of the Catholic Church. And wouldn't you know it, that is what is taking place, is that the church is being paralyzed by saying, hey, nah, the old cycle, that wasn't really it. It's the new cycle. This is what's really it. And I'm saying, wait a minute. You know, how can you serve two masters like that? You know? Yeah, sure, everyone's welcome, but you cannot appeal to everyone. You cannot appeal to both truth and lies equally. How is that possible? It's not possible. So this is like, remove the stops from the activists in this world who most certainly are going to make their moves just now with unimpeded swiftness. They feel very emboldened. They've won the battle. It's over in their minds. It is over. And unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, it's just a fact. There's nothing that anyone can do about it at this point. Not really. Actually, change. It's like the Indians and the colonialists, and at a certain point they had so much power, the Indians were doomed. You know, they fought some valiant battles, but they couldn't win anymore. No way could they win. And so you have to be wise at this time, and you have to realize where you're at in history, and you have to say, you know what, I want to get the answer to those question marks. Look at the answer to those question marks. Because I don't feel like I want to be embroiled in what is to take place. It's called the tribulation period. Head-busting time. And it's talked about in the Bible. And we're warned that this is what's going to happen. There's people from a new cycle. They called it an evil and adulterous generation. But, you know, basically a generation that has very different values than the older style. Coming into this world, taking it over, putting their leaders in power over the planet, and busting heads. And so that is now here. It is now here. How bad the head busting will be, I don't know. But ideological head busting is bound to be severe. It's already incredibly severe. Crippling, as a matter of fact. Crippling blows are being landed. Daily. That's why I try to stop looking at the news. It's just too depressing. You just say, oh my gosh, we lost this one, we lost that. The old cycle certainly is losing on all fronts. It's a rout. It is a rout right now. It's very, very depressing. But my purpose is not to be depressed, but to clarify this option for us, the third phase option. What are our options, really, not what we're told yet. What are the options, really? Let's bring the Holy Spirit into the picture. Let's bring him in the picture. Will some great guru show up? I don't know. I'm not going to hold my breath on that one. If they do, they do. They don't. But we could still clarify. The Holy Spirit can clarify for us what our options are. So, don't panic. Don't freak out. Don't get depressed. You can think about it, but don't do it. And stay centered. Keep breathing. Stay calm and say, okay, we are going to get a clarification coming up now. So, all ears, good focus, clear focus. And let's see what that brings us. Okay, very good. That's it for this one.